Welcome back, everyone, to The Nightmare. Now we're going to talk about zombies. We're going to hear from Thomas Fricke. He's a cloud and Kubernetes security artifact and CTO of EndoCode. He's going to tell us about zombies and Kubernetes and how you can bend them into containers. So Thomas, take it away.
Yeah, hello, everybody. So welcome to the Kubernetes Nightmare. And this is my background. So normally I do system automation, SEC, DevOps, cloud security architect. And I'm effectively doing Kubernetes since 500 plus years. at least it feels like that. And Linux since 0.95, which is, a lot of time. I do Kubernetes trainings, networking, security, OpenShift, not the usual stuff, not the introduction. And I'm member of several boards to get open source onboarded in the German government, in critical infrastructure, things like that. So this is my background. You see Kubernetes now popping up everywhere. You see it in deadly machines. You see it in ships and trains and energy distribution. I've had several projects in healthcare, and you see it in 5G networks, so it's more or less everywhere. So it's time to ask some questions about security. Currently, I'm in a project where I'm going into a power grid, and we want to control things in the power grid with Kubernetes. So it's critical infrastructure, it's highly regulated, it's quite international, this means on a European scale. And this is not your good old Pokemon Kubernetes anymore, because if we do something wrong, we could break the power grid. So security is a big issue here, and we start now looking deeper into it. And effectively, what we see is, it's close to Halloween. The Kubernetes story can be mapped to a horror plot. So we have this poison promise of cloud native made easy, or CI/CD, or as Holly has talked about, continuous doom in the last talk. There is this house at the end of the street. So this is the Kubernetes cluster. We have all the curious teenagers you normally see in Hollywood horror movies. So these are the developers, the DevOps people. And the old graveyard, obviously, is Docker Hub. You have buried secrets, because you can run foreign code as root, which is never a good idea and never in no system. You have this book with old unforgotten magic the teenagers find after a while. So this is a forgotten art of Linux system engineering. And you have the portal to the underworld. So this means you get access to files on the host if you don't care about security, or your cloud provider did not care about it. And then you have this unforgiven crime, which means you get access to host sockets API server, which is standard in vanilla Kubernetes. And then the evil awakens, which means there is a container outbreak. You can take over an entire host or cluster. And then the dance of the vampire starts. So you have the cluster pawned, and then at least you see you need countermeasures. As usual, there are these Ghostbusters or Van Helsing-like people, the research chefs are called. And then you try to throw garlic, silver bullets, holy crosses on the problem. So this means SE Linux, port security policy, forbid host access, network policies, and things like that. Finally, you have the spells against evil, which means you try to close your cluster, you do image signing, use the open policy or agent and audit logs, and finally you banish the ghost, which is more or less not a technical issue, it's a spiritual thing, which means for me, this is SEC DevOps. Security people should be involved in the Agile teams, and this is something I'm designing with my customers at the moment on the process level. So this is a non-technical task. Yeah, what we see here, this is a very old pattern. Red Hat has called it's a wormhole. So in very early versions of Kubernetes, it was quite common to offer the Docker socket to a container that you can start build processes inside a container, which makes totally sense in the build system. What you do here is you have a standard BusyBox container. You do volume mounts, which means you import the Docker socket into the container, which should not be possible in a production-like environment, but it is still the default. And then you simply import the Docker binary into your container, which actually works or has worked some time ago, placing or taking over the Docker binary from the host. So this worked a few years ago, and then I saw it's broken. I have thought it has been fixed, but it has not really been fixed. So what you see here is the return of this attack, which definitely works. So I checked it yesterday in a cloud nearby. And what you see is you simply, to take over a cluster from inside a pod, you need a Docker binary statically linked. Here it is. You can wget it. Then you place it in your container by using this Docker file. Immediately, so it's a three-liner, and then here is a kind of cloud bomb which circumvents Kubernetes and effectively uses the direct access to the Docker socket to start an infinite number of arbitrary applications here for whatever reason, Nginx. So you're effectively bombing the cluster with Nginx things, and Kubernetes does not take notice of it. This is not the whole truth. After 125 Nginx started in a typical GKE node, it's running out of IP addresses, and then the host is broken. This would mean the cluster is not available anymore. Kubelet is broken. Everything is broken. And then this pod, if it would be a deployment, would be rolled out onto the next node. And the story repeats here. And because the Docker socket is not controlled by Kubelet, Kubernetes does not take notice about this. So it's just the same old thing. You have this binary alive here. Okay, so next step. We have now Containerd or Creo, and this means I'm safe. No, you can repeat more or less the same story with Containerd and Creo. So you have to use a different kind of tools. Here is a Creo tool you can place into your BusyBox cluster, so it's also statically linked. Only configuration you have to do, and it's different from a Creo. You need to create a kubectl YAML, which is placed in etc somewhere, and then you can take over this cluster the same way you have done with Docker. And now the next thing is you can do it with Creo or kubectl. So Containerd and Creo works the same. So you have taken over the cluster effectively, and you can test it with the same kind of cloud bombing, and this works. Okay, what is the situation for your homework? If you're interested in them, you can read for your confusion the security advices of the cloud providers. Here you see the typical cloud providers, and the information is not really helpful because it's messed up. It's too long to read. It's confusing. It's wrong, even not telling the right thing about what you are doing. So Google tells you about hardening your cluster security, and effectively it talks about identity and access management, which is something completely different. And security in EKS, it's the same. I did not even understand what EKS is meaning here. We had several security flaws in the cloud, therefore. And yeah, this is the story. Not even IBM does it right, because it's not explaining you what you need for Kubernetes security in the cloud. It's explaining what you can do on premises. This is completely right, but they completely missed their topic. Okay, so the conclusion, which is what I found out and can only repeat, the default security is very low in the clouds, so you don't have a level which is acceptable, in my opinion. And what they are weaseling around is, Kubernetes is not multi-tenant, it's just whatever cluster for one team, one user. They don't even explain what a tenant is. And so my conclusion is the multi-tenant version is OpenShift, which is quite expensive, and it's a different adventure and not easy to install. And what we see is the default in the clouds should be much better. So the default cluster, you can click with a few mouse clicks in all these environments, has a very low hanging security. If you are interested in that, you can do this with the Creo runtime test cluster to repeat. You can even use a pod security policy enabled cluster. Use a statically linked kubectl binary, and then in the container D, you could deploy something with the same rights the container has been used to deploy. If somebody has read the documentation here of all the cloud providers and has used the cluster admin role, effectively taking over the container means you are cluster admin now. And you can take over your test clusters quite easily. So please check your clusters if this works in your cluster. And please don't run this in production, because this is still working. So the situation is, for me, like this, all clouds are broken in a similar way, and you need to do a lot of effort on how to get the clouds, the Kubernetes clusters at least, secure. And what we see here is again the pattern we have seen years ago by Microsoft. They give you all the information to secure your cluster, but this puts such a high load onto the developers or the DevOps people that you have no chance to understand it all in the typical project environment. What I would like to see is a secure Windows, because we see all the ransomware now, and you might have seen the Kubernetes KubeCon talk by Ian Coldwater, where she talks about the advanced persistent threats. If we would not have a mess in Windows because Kubernetes would be omnipresent or ubiquitous, then the APT would go against Kubernetes and take over the cluster. At the moment, Windows is a more attractive goal, but we should not wait until Kubernetes is more attractive to mess up than Windows. Countermeasures are well known. So you can use SE Linux or AppArmor, which is hard to install. And here you see the links. The presentation will be public. It's going to Red Hat. It shows how you get SE Linux policies for your Docker container that excludes access to sockets and other things like run C. You should use the pod security policies. Unfortunately, this is breaking all the stable Helm charts and most of the internet examples. So this is not very popular, but in a secure environment, you need to do it, and you need to be placed on a ground which is really secure. This is, And this is the advice to the cloud providers. Please give us secure default clusters and not this crap for playing around and addressing cloud naive people, not cloud native people. But for the users, this means don't run any code from an unknown source as root with your privileged accounts. And this is not necessary. So the cloud architects should be addressed. You don't need these privileges for your applications. If you need some privileges because you have to increase a special limit on the host, like for big databases like Elasticsearch, you can split this task, run it in a different namespace, and use it to get better access and the separation of concerns. You should never run a privileged application with connection to the internet. This is what we have learned so far. Okay, this is one zombie which is actually still alive. So we have no secure clusters at the moment. By default, some host providers are offering them, but this is not the popular and not the common ground. Okay, something completely different, the second zombie I've promised. You might have seen Windows has a long history of server versions which are still active. And here you see all the latest versions. Windows 7 is dead. Windows Vista is dead, Windows XP is dead, and here we would have Windows XP, and here somewhere in the background, even Windows 95, and you would not believe it. It's a critical infrastructure. So a critical infrastructure is kind of graveyard of dead operating systems. SCADA from the 90s, without any idea of security, it must be highly isolated. I've seen Windows 95 systems doing traffic management really in operations on big German autobahn highways. So this is something you would not expect. Windows 95 is unpatchable. And even if I talk to people in critical infrastructure, somebody stands up and says, oh, you have seen this old system. I have seen a system which is even older than your system, and it's in active control of really important hardware of operational technology. This is sometimes a base for control centers, and it must be highly isolated. So therefore I have to go into the dungeons of the critical infrastructure operating center and do work in parts which have no connections to the public internet. And I hate this. An idea of isolating this zombie is just place it in a container. So here is a container which can be configured with a few lines of code and scripts as a QEMU system. So it's a hypervisor running inside a container. This works quite well. So we are quite popular. There is an entire project, KubeVirt, which does a more sophisticated solution on that, but we can use it even in an Alpine system, which is quite easy to install. And now we can run the zombie. Here is a pod how to run a Windows 10 zombie in a container with open with a Windows inside. The only trick is you have to include this disk, this Windows image disk somehow in a mount pass. So I've mounted it simply into the container. And then the next trick is you need to expose it through NoVNC, and then you have an isolated Windows application, an isolated Windows operating system, which can be exposed to a service through VNC. And then you have a container with a zombie inside and up and running, and it's quite controlled. We can control the zombies. Here it's an example with standard network policies. You can open a port, and of course you have to open DNS which is standard in network policy. And then you have all the stuff. So I'm showing you that demo here. So you, this is a zombie. And actually what you see, it's a real life Windows operating system. You can run and reboot. And then you see the typical reboot process in between. I can show you the Jupyter lab I've created. It will be uploaded, so the link will be on the last slide. And here you see the network policies we apply, all the solutions, and this is something you can check in a typical Minikube environment if you don't have access to real hardware, and this is the starting part. So where's the VNC now? Zombie is starting. Oh, it takes some load because I'm in parallel using Zoom here. And here it is starting. You don't even need a password, because it's completely isolated and controlled. And now we have a zombie. And to scare you a little bit, it's 25 years old, so it's probably older than some people in the audience. And this was the first version of a Windows Explorer. And if you have your... the mouse is not really usable well. Here you see the up-to-date page of view of Google. It's quite hard to find pages which allow HTTP access in our times, because the default is HTTPS, and the TLS implementations have changed over time, and the good old Internet Explorer is not able to resolve TLS. So this works. So we have networking here. And more, and if you use for something, you see all the images are broken. We have more modern formats here. So this is a Linux search of Google today with an old logo, and it's the view is completely broken. And that's what we can do. And now if we want to isolate it, and I would have more time, I would change to the network policies, but I'm afraid we should continue. You can play with the playbook. So here we can have some questions. So if you want to contact me, these are my contact addresses. Here are the examples, my Twitter and LinkedIn account. If you need something on that, feel free to ask me in time, not on the last day. Oh, we have created a cluster, which is a typical story. And now we have to secure it. Why do we have to secure it? Yeah, because we are going live tomorrow. And why is this a problem? We are in a bank and this is finance. So I received this call. This is too late. Do it early, involve security very early, and then we are done. So this is the story, the example, and I'm open to questions now.
Thank you so much for the talk, Thomas. This was great. I really love this subject. I'm certainly going to watch this again and learn how to do this myself. So thanks a bunch. We have maybe 2 minutes, and then we have the panel starting on track one. Let me reload here and see if we have any questions. But I don't think we do. In that case, I think everyone can follow up with Thomas in the later in via email, or you can use the conference Slack, and I think that's where people are chatting the most right now. I'm not sure if you're there, Thomas, but that's where people can go. So we're heading off to the panel now on track one. And we'll be back here on track two a bit later. Quick thanks to our sponsors, our Container Solutions, Equinix, Cycloud, Giant Swarm, Stana, and Kinvolk. Thanks again, Thomas, for the great talk, and see everyone in a bit.
Thank you for organizing everything. See you. Bye.